In this video, we're picking up where we left off in discussing acute inflammation and are moving on to the functional responses that are most important for the destruction of microbes and other inflammatory stimuli. We move through these first two steps of recognizing the offending agent and bringing white blood cells to the appropriate location. And now we're moving on to the actual removal of the inflammatory stimulus. So removal of the stimulus or removal of the agent is just code for phagocytosis and killing. This process occurs in three steps. The first is recognition and attachment of the particle to be ingested. We want to make sure the white blood cells are attacking the right particles, followed by engulfment, which is formation of a phagocytic vacuole by the white blood cell, and then finally killing or degradation of the ingested material. First off is recognition. Now, multiple receptors exist to bind microbes, which can mark them for phagocytosis. One of the most common receptors macrophages have is the mannose receptor, and it is part of the mannose binding lectin pathway of complement activation. That sounds like a mouthful, but what it means is that your white blood cells, like macrophages, have specialized protein receptors, which are called lectins, which bind to very specific carbohydrate patterns which are found on the surfaces of various pathogens like bacteria, viruses, and fungi. And these molecules are only found on pathogen cell walls, so your white blood cells shouldn't get confused between microbes and host cells. Another way the efficiency of phagocytosis is enhanced is when microbes are opsonized by specific proteins, which are called opsonins. And phagocytes express high affinity receptors or are strongly attracted to these opsonins. So opsonins are the proteins that mark pathogens with an eat me sign, and then the phagocytes recognize that eat me sign and will go and engulf those cells. After a particle is bound to phagocyte receptors, extensions of the cytoplasm called pseudopods will flow around it and engulf it, and then the plasma membrane pinches off to form a vesicle called a phagosome that will fully enclose that particle within the white blood cell. That phagosome can then move into the cell and fuses with a lysosomal granule, resulting in a discharge of the granule contents into this phagolysosome. Now, once we've engulfed a pathogen, in this case a microbe, how does your cell actually go about killing it? Killing mechanisms are normally sequestered or kept locked away in lysosomes, and then the phagocytosis materials are brought there. And the first step is the production of reactive oxygen species, ROS, and reactive nitrogen species, RNS. The reactive oxygen species are produced by an enzyme which can oxidize NADPH through a reaction called the respiratory burst, and this releases a superoxide anion, which will then convert into hydrogen peroxide, mostly by spontaneous dismutation, but this product doesn't really efficiently kill microbes by itself. Fortunately, granules within the neutrophils contain another enzyme called myeloperoxidase, or MPO, which in the presence of a halide like chloride ions can convert the hydrogen peroxide to hypochlorite, which is the active ingredient in household bleach. And that is a very potent antimicrobial agent. Now, despite what you may think, inherited deficiencies of MPO by itself actually does not significantly increase an individual's susceptibility to infection, which goes to show there is a bit of redundancy of microbe-killing mechanisms within leukocytes. Another thing that can occur is hydrogen peroxide can get converted to a hydroxyl radical, another powerful destructive agent, and these oxygen-derived free radicals can bind to lipids, proteins, nucleic acids, and those can end up killing cells as well. Unfortunately, oxygen-derived free radicals may also get released into the extracellular environment within certain situations, and that can cause tissue damage and accompanying inflammation. Fortunately, host cells have antioxidant mechanisms that can, to some degree, protect against these oxygen free radicals. Now, alongside that pathway that generates the hydrogen peroxide and hypochlorite, in macrophages, for example, nitric oxide can react with that superoxide and make another free radical called peroxynitrate. Similar to the reactive oxygen species, this can attack and damage lipids, proteins, nucleic acids from microbes. And because that reactive oxygen and reactive nitrogen species have overlapping actions, this is where a bit more redundancy comes into the immune system. And this has actually been tested. There have been knockout mice that have lacked either pathway, and they're actually only mildly susceptible to infections. But if you knock out both of these pathways, then the mice will typically die quite quickly, succumbing to infections from bacteria that are normally in existence that just overwhelm the host defenses. And then lastly, in addition to its role as an antimicrobial substance, nitric oxide can also relax vascular smooth muscle and promote some vasodilation. And within neutrophils and monocytes, which are the main white blood cells seen in acute inflammation reactions, there are many different lysosomal granules that can contribute to microbial killing, and when they're released can also contribute to a bit of surrounding tissue damage as well. These granules can contain substances such as lysozyme, collagenase, histamine, alkaline phosphatase, myeloperoxidase, as well as various acid hydrolases and a bunch of other different proteases. Now, when the granules fuse with the phagocytic vacuoles that contain those engulf material, that granule can dump its contents into there. But unfortunately, like we were saying before with the reactive oxygen species, if those get dumped into the extracellular space, that can also cause some surrounding inflammation. And because of the destructive effects of these lysosomal enzymes, there is a sort of a counterpoint to these harmful proteases that typically exist in your serum and tissue fluids normally. And this primary anti-protease is called alpha-1 antitrypsin. And a good way to remember what this does is if you can recall from GI physiology, trypsin is an enzyme that your pancreas produces for the dietary breakdown of proteins. So an anti-trypsin would act against something that breaks down proteins. Another mechanism your immune system has against pathogens are neutrophil extracellular traps. These will literally trap microbes within their fibrils to prevent their further spread. And this fiber network has a high concentration of antimicrobial substances that can also be brought out at the site of infections. And neutrophils stimulated by pathogens, mainly bacteria and fungi, and inflammatory mediators, will undergo this process of creating these extracellular traps. Now these traps are a kind of a viscous meshwork of nuclear chromatin that can bind and concentrate granule proteins that we were just mentioning a few slides ago. These are the antimicrobial agents that can get brought directly out to the microbes. Unfortunately, in the process of this trap formation, the nuclei of the neutrophils are often lost, and so it's sort of a one-way trip for these neutrophils. Now, leukocytes can damage normal cells under certain circumstances. If there is prolonged activation as part of a normal defensive reaction, sometimes infections are difficult to eradicate, and the inflammatory reaction from your own immune cells can cause more damage than the microbe itself. If the inflammatory response is inappropriately directed against host tissues, such as in certain autoimmune diseases, this can be problematic. And then if the immune system reacts excessively against normally harmless environmental substances, like in allergic diseases, this can cause a bunch of host damage as well. And in all of these situations, the ways in which leukocytes are actually damaging normal tissues are the same as the mechanisms involved in normal antimicrobial defense. But once the leukocytes are activated, they kind of just get blinders on. They can't tell between an offender and a host. So this really highlights the importance of the earlier stages of recognizing the correct particles and making sure that the immune reaction is directed appropriately. Also, as we mentioned before, controlled secretion of granule contents is a normal response of activated leukocytes. But if phagocytes encounter materials that can't be easily ingested, such as immune complexes, which are deposited on immovable flat surfaces, a good example of this is glomerular basement membrane. The inability of leukocytes to surround and ingest these substances, called frustrated phagocytosis, can actually stimulate a large amount of release of these lysosomal enzymes into the extracellular environment. Also, some phagocytosed substances, such as urate crystals, can actually damage the membrane of the phagolysosome itself, and that can lead to the accidental release of the lysosomal granule content. Now, there are some other functions of leukocytes as well. One of the primary ones, especially seen in macrophages, are the production of cytokines, which can both amplify or limit the inflammatory reaction. These macrophages can also produce growth factors, which will stimulate the proliferation of endothelial cells, fibroblasts, and collagen synthesis. And they can also produce enzymes that can end up remodeling connective tissue. And because of these functions, macrophages are also an important cells seen in chronic inflammation and tissue repair, especially after the initial inflammation has subsided.